role of youth in future space program of India. Last year, ISRO launched 104 satellites using the PSLV launch vehicle and created history. Out of the satellites launched for foreign customers, 88 of them were from Planet Labs of USA. These satellites were for Earth observations. Each satellite weighed only 3.5 kilograms. Last year, in the month of May, I was able to visit this particular place near San Francisco and found out that this was a very, very small place with a very small team, but they were able to make all these satellites. And in the discussions there, I found out that they were able to make 5 satellites per week. That's a very, very tall order, as I could see. And in that small place, I was also able to see there were about 6 to 8 people from Indian origin. Launch of 104 satellites using one PSLV vehicle was successful, but this will be a very, very difficult record to beat. ISRO will be able to continue to provide the necessary launch capability for a large number of small satellites. This capability will provide many opportunities to the young persons. On 12th January 2018, just now, ISRO launched 31 satellites successfully using the PSLV launch vehicle. Last year, there was a failure of the heat shield opening mechanism. This was overcome. The main satellite was Cartosat 2 of ISRO. A nano satellite and a micro satellite from India were the two other satellites. 28 other satellites were made by USA, France, Finland, UK, South Korea, and Canada. In this flight, the 100th satellite of ISRO was launched. In one of the small satellites that was launched, one of the ideas that came, if I'm not mistaken, from Sweden was that why not launch a simple mobile telephone in space and find out how it actually works? Because in the future, it could provide proper communications to the astronauts in space. 60 years ago, the satellites made by human beings were launched in the orbit of the Earth for the first time. The first satellite was Sputnik 1, launched by USSR on 4th October 1957. The second satellite was Explorer 1, launched by USA on 31st January 1958. The space era had begun then. This was the first satellite, Sputnik 1, very, very small satellite. The next one was the Explorer 1. How did we get there? This is something which happened there outside. The Physical Research Laboratory, or PRL, was established by Dr. Vikram Sarabhai in 1948. Dr. K.R. Ramnathan and Dr. Vikram Sarabhai were the pioneers in space research in our country, and both had worked with Sir C.V. Raman. Research in cosmic rays and effects of solar activity on the upper atmosphere were the main thrust areas. The year 1957 was declared as the International Geophysical Year. What was thought at that time was that the solar activity will be at its maximum, and if international cooperation can be achieved, we can get the data from all over the world. The idea was as to how solar activity actually affects the upper atmosphere. Now, you must remember, this happened at a time when there were no communication satellites. Our communication was being done through high-frequency radios, and the radios were maximally affected by the solar activity. PRL, that is National Physical Laboratory in Delhi, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Mumbai, and many other universities in India were working at this particular time and provided the data. The International Geophysical Year was extended for 1958 also. In 1960-1961, we established our first telemetry reception station given by NASA at the Physical Research Laboratory, Ahmedabad. And I had started my work at Physical Research Laboratory, Ahmedabad in 1960. I am still active. Recognizing the importance of the space research in our country, in February 1962, the Indian National Committee for Space Research, INCOSPAR, was established with Dr. Vikram Sarabhai as the chairman. It was decided that we should establish a rocket launching station near the geomagnetic equator. The plan was to use this particular station to launch rockets and study what are the effects of the equatorial electrojet, that is a very large current that flows in the upper atmosphere. A first team of four engineers was sent to USA, and I was fortunate to be one of them. The first Nike Apache rocket carrying sodium vapor payload was launched on 21st November 1963. Within less than 6 months, we were able to learn and start our work. So that's our first team, Ramkrishna Rao, Prakash Rao, myself, Mr. Arvamudan, and Mr. Murthy. And then two other engineers joined, APJ Abdul Kalam and Ishwar Das. Mr. APJ Abdul Kalam was the first person which we started working with, because he was the only aeronautical engineer amongst all of us. This is at when we were starting the work for actually getting the data. And this is how we launched our first rocket, Nike Apache, on the launch pad and the launch. But at this time, let me just again tell you one thing. When we were working, we had a problem at this Thumba rocket launching station. We had only one Jeep. How do we transport all the things that are needed? So bicycle was our answer. That's Kalam and Arvamudan. And that's myself, again, adjusting a payload. Dr. Vikram Sarabhai and Dr. Homi Bhabha had visited us there at that particular time. And Dr. Bhabha was instrumental in saying that, okay, we should really now proceed with development of all of our own rockets also. And we started the work. The Thumba Equatorial Rocket Launching Station was dedicated to the United Nations by Mrs. Indira Gandhi. She visited us for the first time there. And now it's going to be 50 years to that date, because it's going to be on the 2nd of February 1968. And most probably I'll be in Thumba Equatorial Rocket Launching Station. In 1968, Buckminster Fuller, a very important architect, had written a book, Operating Manual for Spaceship Earth. He had thought that, why are we talking about astronauts going in the space? We ourselves are in space. We are going around the sun at a speed of 30 kilometers per second. So we should consider ourselves to be in space itself, and then start working in such a fashion that an astronaut is taught how to work with limited resources, nothing externally available. So in the same way, we on the Earth, we should be actually looking at it. Early in the last decade, when our former president, APJ Kalam, was asked about his age, he had indicated that he was in the 73rd orbit around the sun. Once our work started, we started working with our own rockets, like RH-300. The Indian space program, right from the very beginning, was driven by science on one side and applications of that particular technology for the betterment of our life in day-to-day. The applications which we had in our mind were space communications, Earth observations and meteorology. Navigation was later on added. That's in the first station which we built in 1965-67. This was imported, but this was followed up by our own station, which was built in 1970-1971, and that is still operational, that particular station, called as Vikram 1 in near Pune. 1975 saw our first satellite being launched, that was Aryabhatta, followed by Rohini. That's the Rohini satellite on the SLV launch vehicle. What you see here is Dr. Kalam, Professor Satish Dhawan, Srinivasan, and that's our SLV-3. Again, when we had a situation that we had to test our antennas and we wanted a vehicle which does not have that much of metal in it, so obviously bullock cart is the answer for that. That's the satellite INSAT 1B, for which I was the project director, and this was the satellite that was launched on the Space Shuttle Challenger. Later on, Challenger met with an accident, but that was the time when we were actually working on these satellites, the satellite being released. 1994, that was the first PSLV successful, and after that I retired. We had to develop quite a large number of applications connected with agriculture, geology, connected with water resources. In each one of these applications, we started the work, but finally it has now gone to such an extent that almost thousands of people are working in these applications, not only in ISRO, but they are working in almost all the states. Every state has their own remote sensing applications center. One of our most successful stories has always been search for underground water. That's the GSLV which had followed up with it. After that, we had the Chandrayaan. Chandrayaan was our first major attempt to get out of the Earth and get into the orbit of the Moon. And that's some of the pictures from the Moon. And we were very fortunate that our instruments were able to actually find that the presence of water on Moon. This was followed with our Mars-related experiment, Mangalyaan. Mangalyaan, we are still analyzing the data as to what exactly was coming up. This was one of the very important pictures that which we got. And then we have followed up with our AstroSat. So we had Earth applications, we had science-related applications. One of the major applications which we had was the satellite for meteorology. Our first satellites carried the meteorological packages. Later on, we followed up with an independent satellite completely devoted only for meteorology. It is from such satellites which we get pictures like this every day. Every day, more than 20 pictures we collect. If there is a storm, we collect even more pictures. We have done the experiment on the satellite recovery experiment or space recovery experiment. First capsule that was brought back and followed now by GSLV Mark III. This is the largest vehicle which we have built so far. GSLV Mark III suborbital flight has been successful. It was the test of our crew ascent as well as for re-entry vehicle as a module. And on June 5 last year, GSLV Mark III was used to successfully launch a heavy satellite, GSAT-19. We have now achieved what was indicated in the 1969 decade profile issued by Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. In the future, we should be able to this vehicle for large communication satellites. This will reduce our dependence on foreign launch vehicles. For some time, USA had the monopoly of having their own navigation system as GPS. The GPS, some of the accuracies were denied to others. And that had really prompted India to go ahead and establish our own Indian region navigation satellite systems. It is now a completed system. And now we have followed up with a reusable launch vehicle as a technology demonstrator. And one very important satellite on which I worked was by providing only guidance to the students. Now this is a satellite made by the College of Engineering in Pune. It's only 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters, weighs only 1 kilogram. But the idea was extremely important of using completely passive stabilization for that particular satellite. And the students had completely made this particular satellite. So when we talk about work in ISRO or in the future, for us, we must remember, Make in India was not just a slogan for us. It was the way of our work. It was a necessity. Self-reliance was the key since many options were closed. You can be working in any discipline. Work related to space requires passion, patience, and perseverance. It requires ability to work in multidisciplinary teams. Work for the Indian space program is not carried out only in the ISRO centers and laboratories. A large number of industries and universities are contributing to this work. Without their support, this work could not have been carried out. So where are the future opportunities? What are we looking at? And this is where I come back. When we were young, we started certain things. Now all of you are young. You should be coming up with your own ideas. Give those ideas, publish them, and make certain that such type of things are possible. If you think that it is possible, if you are not violating any physical law, then I can say that yes, you will succeed in it. Space-based astronomy, material processing in space. About 8 years ago, there was a conference in Thiruvananthapuram. One of our civil engineers there had come up with the idea that if we had to build something on the moon, how can we actually utilize the material that is already available on the moon? And that's how people have to come up with their own ideas also. Manufacturing in space, on the moon and on other planets. For some time, many people were thinking that manufacturing in space is going to be easy with the 3D printing and new technologies. But when they actually started working on it, they found out printing something with that kind of a technology under the zero-g condition is entirely different. Under 1/6 gravity is entirely different. Mining of materials on asteroids. Many people have talked about availability of the gold, availability of some of the other exotic materials, but mining of collecting helium-3 on moon for nuclear fusion energy generation. Because if we want to put something on the moon, there are going to be a continuous 15 days of night. And that particular time, we require energy. Where is this energy going to come from? And that's where helium, people initially started saying that, okay, let us collect helium-3 there and get it back here. Instead of getting it back, let us use it there. There could be solar cells for orbital maneuverings. So the next satellite from Pune University will have this concept. Vertical takeoff and vertical landing. SpaceX has shown that yes, it can be done. Question is, can we do it? Can our young people actually do it? Planetary exploration with landers and rovers. People are talking about all these satellites and we have got various problems connected with the space debris also. If we try to destroy that thing using explosives, something is going to be wrong because we are going to create larger and larger debris. Instead of that, using lasers to actually completely evaporate them. Search for life or food processing. Space tourism and international law. Commercial space business. There are many people who are getting into it now. It was decided that we are going to insure our first satellite, INSAT 1, the government had sent the team from the General Insurance Corporation. They said, we don't know anything about space. I said, I don't know anything about insurance. Let us work together. And that's how we developed our insurance policies also. There could be use of available data. Whatever is already available, use it in a different innovative fashion. Defense applications for surveillance and communications. Let me end this thing with two quotations. This is by Robert Frost. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. And Pramod Batra wrote this one, when you reach for the stars, you might not actually get one, but you also will not come up with a fistful of mud either. Thank you.